for the 25th consecutive year, the Professional Bowlers Tour. In our first match, our number five qualifier, last year's top bowler and leading money winner, Mike Aulby. He meets Doug Wallace, a third-year pro, bowling in his first championship round. Qualifying third, Peter Hakim, the local favorite from Forest Hills, New York, seeking his first tour victory. The number two position belongs to 23-year-old Ron Palombi, Jr., whose only tournament victory came 2 years ago. The winner then will meet the tournament leader, 30-year-old Storm DeVincent, seeking his first tour victory. All today on the Professional Bowlers Tour. And not that far from the heart of Manhattan is Garden City, Long Island. Since 1963, we've been coming back to this spot for great competition among the professional bowlers of the world. Hello again, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Chris Schenkel. We welcome you to our 14th telecast in a series of 16. Today, we have three right-handers and two left-handers. The one left-hander is a non-winner. He's a local hero, Peter Hakim. Now, the other left-hander is the bowler of the year in 1985, over $200,000 earned, Mike Aulby of Indianapolis, Indiana. He is also the defending champion. Last year, in his six victories, he had to win four games to win the Denver Open. He did it. Can he do it today? There are some hungry bowlers ahead of him. Speaking of hunger, here's a guy that just loves television and professional bowling. Nelson Burton, Jr. Bo, welcome.
Thank you, Chris. Well, I think you said it right. Inexperienced is our field today, but we have the top guy in the number one match, Mike Aulby. $200,000 last year, bowler of the year, the defending champion. He's the man to beat. But the real story this week has been the scoring. After 14 weeks on ABC's Pro Bowlers Tour, this week turned out to be the highest scoring of the year. Our tournament leader, Storm DeVincent, averaged 253 in one of his eight-game blocks, 235 for the whole tournament, 42 games. We had six perfect games so far in the tournament. And I say so far, because in this bowling center in 1978, the last legitimate shot at a 300 game was Johnny Petraglia. He had 11 in a row before he got an eight count for a 298 game. Now, we have a good shot at somebody picking up that $100,000 for a 300 game today. But one thing is really for sure, we'll have a lot of strikes, a lot of exciting action. We're ready to go, Chris.
All right, and the money at stake today in winning the Long Island Open is $18,000, $9,500, $7,500, $4,500 to the man that doesn't finish on top here in our very first game. Doug Wallace, rookie, his first television appearance ever, this 25-year-old, Portland, Oregon, is going against the defending champion of this event and bowler of the year, Mike Aulby. And Mike is a little frustrated. This is only his second championship round appearance of this year after his great 1985. 26 years old. Bye-bye. Now, that is one. And of course, as you all know, you need 12 of those in order to bowl a perfect game. And as Bo alluded to the $100,000, we've waited for years to give it away. And I can't think of a better day, Bo.
Good chance today, Chris. They can throw a lot of strikes. The reason the lanes score so high is the pin carry is almost automatic. When they hit the 1-3 or 1-2 pocket, a strike more often than not.
Doug Wallace, the man with an unusual style, hooking the ball into the pocket. His style works, Nelson.
A free spirit, Chris. He just kind of walks up there with the ball, drops it by his side, opens up that hand at the top of the swing, good knee bend on his pivot step, then just unleashes that ball at the bottom of the swing, starts at about the 25th board on the lane, 39 being across the lane, out to about the fifth board, back into the pocket.
Here he is, 5'8", 175 pounds. Now, outwardly, we would have to say he's the loosest bowler we've had all year, but inwardly, I know he is a little uptight, but he is strung. He has doubled here in our very first match. Doug Wallace and now Mike Aulby.
That's what makes big scores when you hit around the pocket. He hit the 1-3 very high, caved in the strike, has started with a double.
in there with a double. The man on this championship pair averaging 256 in two games is off and winging. Here's a replay.
Mike Aulby, with that smooth style that we saw so often last year in his six victories, lays the ball down very softly at the foul line. Good extension, nice follow through, plays the big hook, ball into the 1-2 pocket. The match is all even after two frames.
Young man that was the Professional Bowlers Association Rookie of the Year in 1979, two-time PBA national champion, and only 26. He has three in a row. We're at Garden City Bowl. New York's Long Island. From the front, this view.
The angle played by Mike Aulby, sliding right down the center of the lane, over the second arrow, out to about the fifth board. Now watch his reaction as he loves it, that light hit. He starts with three in a row. Doug Wallace has two in a row.
Trails by 10, can't even it up with a strike here. He's on the right lane of this championship pair. Beautiful.
As the players say in the paddock, what a train this player throws. Look at the angle of attack. The ball drives through the 1-3 pins, drives out the 5, 8, and 9. Tremendous hook. 3-pound, 6, 7, and 8-ounce pins we're using this week, the standard pins that we always use. But the players can get a tremendous angle of attack on that pocket, and this is the type of scoring we've seen all week long. Both players perfect through three.
Last year, as a part-time player, was seventh in the Austin Open. And it's a 6-pin.
All right, you see the ball crossing over to the left side of the head pin and just pushing out all the pins but the 6-pin. He almost gets a break and gets a strike on this hit. See the 3-pin just sliding by it. Another reason the scores are so high, the splits are not there when you hit high in the pocket.
And the door has been opened for the defending champion, Mike Aulby, after stringing three, an open frame for Doug Wallace.
The shortcoming of Doug Wallace, the big strike ball, but the inability to make a very simple spare has put him into a position where he trails by 13 pins. We'll be back after this message.
And this is from St. Louis, Nelson, Dick Weber, a winner right here.
1976, Dick Weber won one of his 29 national championships, and here's a man who someday may also perform that feat of 29 to 30 national championships. Another Hoosier, Mike Aulby.
Pete Weber, Dick's son, finished 35th. Oh, we've still got the possibility.
What a break.
And you need those. Four in a row for Mike Aulby.
Watch the action, the head pin and the three pin. There it is. He just nicks the three pin. It looks like it's going to stand. Over it goes. Aulby keeps his streak alive, and that's the kind of hits you need to shoot the big game. That one or two off shots, get a break on him, has kept Aulby's string alive. He leads by 23 pins. More importantly, he has four in a row to start the game.
Reality, a round of applause. Fifth frame, leaving the 3-6 on the left lane.
The championship pair for both players, both right-handers and left-handers. The left-hand lane, as Tammy Aulby looks on, hooks a little bit more. Mike just sent that ball wide and left the 3-6 a simple spare to maintain a 21-pin lead.
Had a few anxious moments at the line. He's patting the solar plexus. Well, perhaps the butterflies are gone now. And in the case of non-winner Doug Wallace of Portland, Oregon, who up to now, as a three-year member of the PBA, has earned $15,988. Interesting style, interesting young man. The great hook stroke, the hook shot. We asked him earlier what he must learn to become more consistent on the tour.
Well, Bo, I think it's very important for me to pick up my spares. I've always had trouble with them. Staying firm in crucial situations. I have a habit of letting up on the ball a little bit and setting it a little short. Spares most important, though, for me, I think.
There you see the open frame in the fourth. Coming right back with a strike. Now the sixth frame. And a high hit, leaving the 3-6-9-10.
Well, he had trouble making the six pin, and once again, he goes very high right here. Just drives through the pins and leaves the 3-6-9 pins. The 10 pin is the key pin to carry out.
Walter Ray Williams, our only two-time winner this year. He finished 31st in the Long Island Open.
And you see the style of Doug Wallace, that extreme left-hand side of the approach, using all the lane, sliding, throwing the ball over the fourth arrow, sending it out to that 3-6-9 spare, which he converted. But here's Aulby up, six frame, 21 pin lead.
Spare working for Aulby. The winner of our first game will meet Peter Hakim, a non-winner from Forest Hills, New York.
No doubt about this strike, solid in the 1-2 pocket, driving all 10 pins in a pin.
And Hakim off to our right, if you hear pinfall, is practicing, waiting to meet the winner. He's practicing a lot. Very organized young man. Great hockey fan. Seven pin.
First time a player has hit the pocket today and has not come away with a strike. Wallace has hit the pocket four times in his six frames. Aulby has hit the pocket six out of seven shots, has five strikes to show for.
Garden City Bowl, just adjacent to historical Mitchell Field here on Long Island. All right. Continuing to mark is Mike Aulby of Indianapolis, Indiana, leading by 21 pins. This is our first game. We're live from Long Island, and we'll be back. This game, you will hear some rooting because he's a hometown favorite, Peter Hakim, a lefty, and he continues to practice. All right, Mark Breland, undefeated in 10 fights, going against the man, the only man to defeat him, in the amateur ranks. And that's going to be a neat fight. Good. Anthony has a chance.
Well, I don't know, the revenge factor, Chris. Anthony, granted a couple years ago, could stay with Breland, but Breland will put him away early this time.
Okay. All right, and, you know, whitewater canoeing, which I first saw at the Munich Olympic Games. Is that ever exciting? Watch it today in Wide World. Just as you watched another strike by Hookin' Doug Wallace.
We're seeing a lateral attack on the pins today. Wallace from the right side, Aulby from the left. The extreme sharp angle towards the pocket rewards you with a strike every time that you can get in there. Once again, a Wallace is a dangerous type player to compete against, Chris, because he can throw strikes at any time, and he's just a free spirit out there. He can beat himself, but then he can throw five or six in a row to close the gap.
Aulby not looking. And the man that sold shares in himself to get out on the tour. Got a little expense money in his pocket, left the 10 pin.
Solid 10. Ball breaks in. The 6 pin is airborne as it goes around the 10, and that was a key shot for Doug Wallace to get back in the match. He must convert this spare to trail by still 21 pins through 8 frames.
Makes it look easy. Sort of sits set on that approach and fires away. And here's the methodical Mike Aulby, who led the first two rounds, and then a winner this year, Del Warren, followed by Ron Palombi, who will be bowling two games from now. And then the tournament leader, Storm DeVincent, took over in the fifth and sixth.
18 games of qualifying, 24 match play, 42 in all.
A seven.
Similar shot to what Doug Wallace just suffered through in the previous frame, the solid seven for the left-hander. Aulby had one problem with his bowling 2 or 3 years ago, and it was the inability to make the seven pin. He missed it twice in a championship match in the Grand Prix in Paris, France, 1982, ultimately cost him the title. He's worked on it, and I expect him to make it here in this spring.
Seems to be an era of a collecting craze, and we mentioned Mike being a hockey fan. His main interest in collecting are official hockey pucks. So word gets out, and the hockey players all over North America make sure that they add to Mike's collection. Interesting guy.
Aulby will be going to the Islanders game, which is held at Nassau County Coliseum, which is nearby, and he'll hopefully see an Islanders victory.
And the oohs and ahs of the crowd told you the story. A little audio of what was left down there.
He won't have to worry about a hockey victory tonight, but he's got to worry about his right now. He had this match well in hand, and all of a sudden, an errant shot right here. He leaves the 1-3-7-9, the washout. And if he doesn't convert this, he's opened the door for Wallace to take the lead in the 9th and 10th frames.
And it is just that, an open frame coming at the worst time. Something Mike certainly didn't want, giving him 192 through the ninth. And now with a spare up, shooting in the ninth frame, things are tightening up, Nelson.
Doug Wallace right now going at a 207 pace, trails by 5 pins. If he can strike here in the ninth and the first one in the tenth, he will have the lead. 3 strikes in a row, and he would shut out Mike Aulby.
You know, when he opened in the fourth frame, it almost seemed like that was the end. Not so.
You see the profile of Doug Wallace. He has not missed striking on this right-hand lane. He struck in the first, third, fifth, seventh, and here again in the ninth as you see the ball start down the center of the lane, out to the third board, and just pulverize those pins as he comes into the pocket. But here is the lane that will determine victory or defeat for Doug Wallace today. Trails by 5. If he strikes on this ball, he'll have the lead for the first time in the match.
The 2-4 standing on the left lane. Portland, Oregon's Doug Wallace.
Wallace with a conversion here and a strike would finish with 207. Aulby would need a spare and a 6 count to win the match. Bit discouraged Doug Wallace. His inability to strike on the left-hand lane. He struck there in the second frame, missed a spare in the fourth, missed again in the sixth, eighth, and in the tenth frame, failed to strike again, has opened the door for Aulby. Aulby, a simple task of a spare, will win the match.
So Doug Wallace, hoping to get his first victory here in the Long Island Open, has shot a 207. Now it's up to Aulby. It's in his left hand.
Aulby has been in the pocket every time on this right-hand lane. Strikes in the second, fourth, sixth, solid seven in the eighth. Any kind of mark here in the tenth wins the match.
Not over yet. That is a 3-pin.
Aulby sends it wide. Not a very good shot. You never get defensive on a professional bowler's tour. Leaves the 3-pin, a spare that his brother-in-law, Steve Cook, missed at the True Value Open last year to donate a potential title. Aulby needs this to go on in the next match.
All right. tension-packed first game when you have a 12-time champion, defending champion, bowler of the year. That is hands full with Doug Wallace.
Graphic tells the story. Six pins, he wins the match. Five's a tie. Anything less would probably be in the gutter.
Here it is. For Hakim, and that should be another tester. 211 to 207 is the final score of the first game. So Mike Aulby moves up against Peter Hakim. Don't go away. That match next.
From New York, this ABC Sports exclusive is brought to you by Miller Beer. Miller made the American way since 1855. By Armorall, it's the finishing touch every time you wash your car. And by the Gates Rubber Company, celebrating 75 years of excellence and quality automotive parts. We'll be back with more bowling after these commercial messages and a word from your local station.
And here at the Garden City Bowl, the defending champion Mike Aulby just did it by four pins, 211 to Doug Wallace's 207. Mike with five strikes, Wallace with seven. Now, from Forest Hills, New York, it is Hakim that's going to meet Aulby. And right now we're going to meet the question in asking Bo, which colleges offer bowling scholarships or financial aid? Nelson?
Well, Chris, there are a number of schools around the country, 15 in all, that have volunteered the information to give some sort of financial aid and or scholarships to the youth around the country. And we'll just roll that list through there for you. Indiana State University from your area, Chris, is one of them. You see a few. Robert Morris, we have some great players come out of Robert Morris. Don Janelle, who won this tournament. St. Louis Community College in St. Louis, Flow Valley, my good friend Bill Miller there. And West Texas State and Wichita State's two of the top teams in the country right now.
All right, so if you have a question you'd like Bo to answer, send it to Ask Bo, Post Office Box 1986, Radio City Station, New York, New York, 10101. Okay, now the question is, can non-winner Peter Hakim, who has his hometown fans behind him, he is seated now, 29 years old, can he take the measure of this man, Mike Aulby, won the first game over Doug Wallace, 211, 207. Aulby first. And immediately, it's the 4-6-7-10.
Aulby, being the smart player he is, he'll just try to go for two pins here and not waste the count. The 4-6-7-10, it's makeable, I'd say. The odds maybe 1,000 to 1. Try to slide one of the pins over. But Aulby in the early going will just go for two pins.
So that's kind of eight. Open frame for Aulby, and now we get a look at the 5 foot 11 inch, 175 pound Peter Hakim. First career appearance in the championship round. He's bowled in 18 PBA national tournaments in his 9-year career. Cashed in three of them from the left side. Listen to those hometown fans. Our hero comes through in the first frame.
Peter Hakim in his first shot in championship round just rips that five pin over into the 6-10 area. Starts out with a strike. He's got to love the reaction. Watch this. Come on, ball. Good start. In the match play against the 42 games of match play, Peter Hakim defeated Aulby 258 to 247. One of the real exciting matches we had yesterday.
One of the most powerful strikes we've seen all year. A man that averaged 240 in two games on this championship pair. Peter Hakim. H-A-K-I-M. Now Aulby, after an open frame, shooting in the second. This is the second game for Mike, winning the first 211 to 207. City crowd here at the Garden City Bowl. And in this area, Nelson, they have a lot of terrific league play, the Seaboard Classic League, for instance.
Seaboard Classic, Chris, which bowls in Garden City lanes right here, of which Peter Hakim is a member, one of the top leagues in the country, has historically produced excellent bowlers at the pro level. Aulby for a double.
So there is Tammy Aulby, Mike's wife. And shots like that will make Peter Hakim think, but he seems like a cool competitor that carefully rubbing off that black bowling ball. Double up, third frame. Leads by 22.
And this is the way we started the first match. The ball coming into the 1-2 pocket. He just saws out that 4-7 with a good spin and angle. Peter Hakim off to an excellent start. Three in a row leads. Mike Aulby, the professional bowler's bowler of the year of last year, by 22 pins. Fourth frame for Hakim.
Intimidated by the bowler of the year is this man, who has strung four over Aulby and leads by 32. We'll be back. Set in the making on our second match. Mike Aulby, who won the first 211-207, is going against a non-winner, a local professional named Peter Hakim. Speaking of professional, here's the leading money winner for 1986. He's 1-2 my riverboat gambler, Walter Ray Williams. Welcome.
Walter Ray, 300 this week, but really, why are the scores so good? Is it the pin action, the lane condition, combination of both? What is it?
Well, it's a combination of everything. The lane conditions, very suitable high scores. The pin falls very good here, and just generally good bowling.
As he said, the best bowlers in the world, and you saw evidence of that type of pinfall as Aulby there. Trips the six out, the three pin to the sideboard, trips out the 6-10, and has kept the match alive. Aulby a tough competitor, isn't he, Walter Ray?
You'd like to take the Bowler of the Year title away from him, right, wouldn't you?
Long way to go, though.
That's right, but you're off to a great start.
And here could be one of the best matches of the year. Aulby with a strike here would cut the lead of Peter Hakim down to 12 pins after five frames.
Remember, Mike had only five strikes in his victory over Wallace. And now here after an open frame, he's strung four. And so has Peter Hakim, but did not have an open frame in the first. Perfect through four, now shooting in the fifth frame as Walter Ray Williams Jr. is watching along with Nelson Burton and me. Five. Seven to go. We asked Peter, how does it help him to bowl at his home bowling lanes?
Well, Bo, since I bowl a league here and practice here quite often, and with the crowd behind me, it's going to be pretty exciting today, and I should have a good chance to win.
Chris, well, he bowls in that Seaboard Classic you're talking about with a 209 average in league, and I asked him why he bowled so much more in the tournament. He says his team's so far behind the league, he doesn't try all the time.
Now in the sixth frame. He is halfway. Peter Hakim. Former high school first baseman and outfielder, then into a little semi-pro baseball. Heavily jeweled with two rings on that right hand.
Well, six more strikes and he'll look like a jewelry store.
And a banker.
Don't count this fellow out. No. You don't win 200,000, six titles in the PBA Tour in 1 year, and give up when you're down just 30 pins.
Dancing them off the deck, Mike Aulby. We're in our second match with the winner of this game to meet Ron Palombi Jr., and then the tournament leader, Storm DeVincent.
Aulby getting in a groove. He knows it's there. The last two shots Aulby has thrown have been perfect, relaxed, laid right into the 1-2 pocket. And this is the type of match that forces a player towards perfection, Chris. Hakim has to think about winning this match right now. Forget about the perfect game. The match is still most important at this point.
Mike Aulby leaving the three pin on the left lane of this championship pair.
The left lane has been the story of the day. Wallace couldn't hit it in the first match. Right now, Aulby's struggling on it here in the second match. He opened in the first frame, missed here a strike here in the seventh frame. Once again, he has that three pin, which he has converted every time so far today.
Capacity crowd starting to tense up a bit as their local hero, Peter Hakim, now steps up on the approach. He'll be shooting in the seventh frame. He has strung six. Right lane. Mr. Hakim, that's his dad, Mac. His mother, Marilyn, is here, and his wife, Ellen, is here as well. There's Mom. There's Ellen. Happy.
Everybody's in shock right now. Peter Hakim, first time in a championship round, inexperienced, but you just can't do it any better. Perfect through seven. Five more strikes. Trip to the Firestone, first title, and $100,000. Eighth frame.
Fans here now, his eighth consecutive strike.
Peter Hakim, who has practiced many a game on 21 and 22 at Garden City Bowl, he says it's a pair he practices on when he comes in, and he's showing them what he practices as he runs that out, strings together his eighth strike. Here's Aulby, just pacing at this point.
Another three pin on the right lane this time for Aulby. If you just joined us, he won the first game 211 to 207 over Doug Wallace. He was the fifth, number five qualifier. But he has met Buzzsaw today in Peter Hakim. Well, what's the feeling when you're competing against a man that's strung eight and on his way to perhaps a 300 to the opponent?
Well, there's two thoughts going through Aulby's mind. Really, he can still win this game if Hakim opens in the ninth and tenth frames and Aulby strikes out. So Aulby hasn't given up yet, but in the bottom of his heart, knowing Mike Aulby, he's rooting for Peter Hakim to say, hey, come on, let's shoot it. Shoot the 300. I'll try to get out of your way.
Ninth frame strike. Okay. He's done it eight times. Naturally, we'll be trying for his ninth in a row.
Has three perfect games of his career, 29 years old.
See the relief on his face. Oh, what a heavy bowling ball when you've strung eight. He has now left the seven pin.
What a way to break the string. A near perfect hit, a ringing seven. But Peter Hakim must gather his thoughts. He needs to convert this spare and mark in this frame or the 10th frame to win the match. A spare here would assure him of a victory and go into the semifinal match.
What a performance by the non-winner. Mm-hmm.
The potential for both players. Peter Hakim, if he strikes in the 10th, 11th, and 12th frames, a 279 game. Aulby not to be put down, but still has a potential 246. Tremendous scoring. I think Mike Aulby is saying, well, I kind of wish I didn't lose, and I kind of wish he got 300.
Appreciation of the fans, including Mac Hakim, his pop. So Aulby is out, Hakim is in. We'll go against Ron Palombi Jr. Now, another Nelson Burton Jr. tip. More on practicing your strike lines.
In our practice series involves playing the different strike zones, the outside, the middle, and the inside lines. Remember week one, we warmed up the body. Week two, we practice finding the line, the strike zone. Now, week three comes the real work, practicing the different zones. The first zone we're going to practice is the outside line, out by the first arrow. Move to the right on the approach. When you practice the first arrow, by familiarizing yourself with this zone, you get over the fear of that outside channel. Also, you get to practice throwing a little more speed, which is very important in the sport of bowling, speed control. Watch this shot, the outside line. We've already practiced four frames on the outside line around the first arrow. Now the fifth and sixth frames, we play the normal line, or the most comfortable line for most people, around the second arrow. Move into the second arrow, move your feet more towards the center of the lane, and roll a couple of shots right over that second arrow zone. And finally, for your last few frames, move to the inside line around the third arrow and throw the ball a little slower. This is the toughest line of all, so always practice it. That's it. Remember lesson number three. Practice the outside line around the first arrow with a little more ball speed. Then move for the fifth and sixth frames around the second arrow, your comfortable line. And finally, the real tough line, the last part of this game, move to the third arrow, throw the ball a little bit slower, and work on your hook. This is a very good practice vehicle.
At Garden City Bowl, 267 to 246, and strangely enough, both had nine strikes. Hakim with eight in a row. Seemed well on his way to $100,000. Well, now he's going against Palombi. Maybe he can get it in our semifinal match. We're going to return to our semifinal match here at the Garden City Bowl, but first, this message. City's ABC television tomorrow. Season-long Sunday afternoon games. Mets and Phillies or Blue Jays and World Champion Royals. Live at 3 Eastern.
The Royals confident the Mets need to win every game just to keep up with the Cardinals. And here's a young man who won one PBA title where Mark Fay, his opponent, got five pins on the last ball. The opportunistic Ron Palombi came up and struck in the 10th, 11th, and 12th frames for a one-pin victory in Tucson, 1984, looking for his second title.
From that sports-minded city of Erie, Pennsylvania. Shaker two more, and that three-pin would have gone. Ron Palombi, Jr., 23 years old.
First ball is high on the left-hand lane, as we said, lane 21. Hooks a little bit more than 22. Palombi not giving it enough room, almost gets a break and has a strike. Has to settle for the spare.
And like his opponent, he needs to win in order to be eligible for the Firestone Tournament of Champions 2 weeks from today, where the winner will get $50,000.
And the man sitting on the bubble, or 52nd place, who would get knocked out of that starting field is Dale Glenn, alias the Eagle.
Well, he had nine in his victory over Mike Aulby. So here is Peter Hakim, Forest Hills, New York.
Has that outside-in swing, plays a pretty much of a straight down the line. Mm-hmm. He doesn't hook the ball as much as the other four players in today's quintet, but he throws almost every shot solid in the pocket. A hit similar to the one he left the seven pin on in the ninth frame after starting the previous game with eight strikes in a row.
in his second game of the afternoon. The winner of this game to meet the tournament leader, Storm DeVincent. From up front, look at it.
Two schools of thought of knowing the championship pair as well as Peter Hakim does. If the pair is exactly like you normally practice on them, it's to your benefit. But if the pair happens to change a little bit during the championship round, sometimes you don't adjust. He's been perfect today, has got the pressure on Ron Palombi after just two frames.
And a high hit after Bo lofting that ball way out on the lane.
The good loft, the good lift, and here you'll see it right here on this shot, Chris. He has a good drop down straight push away, head steady, wraps that arm behind his back, curls that wrist. Now watch the lift as you roll the wrist underneath the ball, approximately 6 or 7 feet out on the lane. That helps delay the hook when the ball is breaking very sharply, but he hasn't done it well enough so far. He's been high on both frames.
Oh, power on that shot. He's a big boy, 6'3", 190 pounds. He had games of 279 and 269 throughout the progress of the Long Island Open.
Ron Palombi Jr. is the type of player that likes high scoring lane condition, but likes them very tight. Right now the lanes are hooking a little bit. He doesn't like to have to throw that hard and loft it that much out over the lane. The Tucson Open that he won his first title and only title on were very slick or non-hooking lane conditions. Mm-hmm. Let's see if he can adjust.
Yes, he did. Former high school baseball player, started working at the lanes as a mechanic, and he's learned the mechanics of competing too. Obviously, this professional has as well. He's leading by 12 now, double working, third frame.
Strategy, Chris, the man who knows the championship pair better than anyone else. Number 21 doesn't hook as much as number 22. Move to the left and start the ball towards the pocket. He has done it perfectly, except for two shots all day long.
All right, now for a four bagger on the left lane. They shout Peter here, capacity crowd. And this is our third match of the afternoon. We'll be back.
On the mark at the $125,000 Greater Hartford Open next Saturday on ABC Sports.
From Tamarack, Florida, is this 30-year-old professional, our tournament leader, Storm DeVincent. Very colorful right-hander. He's waiting in the wings, continuing to practice. He will meet the winner of the match now underway, Ron Palombi Jr., whom you're looking now in the striped shirt, going against Peter Hakim, who has a four-bagger up for Palombi. He's trailing by 32. He has a strike up now, the fourth frame. So that double cuts it to 22. We asked him earlier how he stays in shape.
Well, basically to train, I just bowl a lot of practice games. But on my off season, I don't do too much. I play a little basketball with a bunch of my buddies and just like to hang out at the beach.
Like Nelson Burton Jr.
And he has a great jump shot like our producer, Kenny Wolf. But
they teach you that at Harvard?
Albeit. Right now, Palombi needs another strike to cut the lead of Hakim down to 12 pins. Hakim, so far, has been perfect.
High hit leaving the nine.
Palombi at just a pinch high on the left-hand lane. The two-pin goes to the sideboard, takes out the four and the seven, but the ball cooks too much to take out the nine-pin. With this spare, Palombi would have 87 through four, spare up in the fifth.
Well done. Week from today, Nelson and I will be in Winter Locks, Connecticut, bringing you that finals of that tournament. And meanwhile, looking on, you see Ron's parents who have come in from Erie, Pennsylvania, Ron and Linda Palombi, both bowlers.
So it runs in the family. The Greater Hartford Open. Live telecast next Saturday afternoon, 3 Eastern Time, followed by our 16th stop in this 25th year, the $250,000 Firestone Tournament of Champions in Akron.
Oh, no! 5 in a row.
Nelson, I want you to explain that one to our audience.
One of the great breaks. Watch the action of the three pin. It goes a sideboard. It stays in play. Takes out the 2 and the 4 pins. And ironically, the 2 and 4 pins were the two pins that Johnny Petraglia left when he was denied the 300 game back in 1978. When he bowled that 298 game, he left those 2-4 pins. Palombi has, Hakim has now has 5 in a row.
And again, that smile that came after 8 in a row in his first appearance here this afternoon, the string stopping at 5, leaving a 6 pin on the left lane.
Let's see how he is at shooting spares. He hasn't had much of an opportunity to shoot spares. Had 9 strikes in the first match, starting with 8 in a row. He started this match with 5 in a row. A spare here would put him on a 239 pace. Palombi at a 207 pace, 32 pin difference.
So now with a spare up, Ron Palombi will be shooting in the 7th frame. Using all the approach.
Palombi strikes here in the 6th with a powerful shot, and here's his strategy. Number 21, the one he's coming up on, hooks more than 22. He'll move his feet 2 boards to the left on the approach, and on number 21, play the same target as 22 out at the arrows. This is a big shot right here. He trails by 32 pins against the red-hot Peter Hakim. There you see him moving a little farther left on the approach. He needs this shot.
Up now is this Erie, Pennsylvania professional looking for his first win. We'll see if he can get it after this. Alan Buddy Russell, proprietor of the Garden City Bowl, which has staged pro tournaments since 63, and president of the vast Nassau County Bowling Proprietors Association, John Caprice. They have a lot of bowlers in Long Island. They do more than fish in Long Island. They bowl a lot.
And here's one of the members of that Nassau bowling organization, Peter Hakim, representing them. Let's see if he has a letdown. He had 8 in a row the first game, 5 in a row this game, leads by 32.
Leaving the 6-10. Anxious fans here, his fans. Boy that grew up in Forest Hills, as did our senior vice president who came to visit us today. Michigan State's own Dennis Lewin.
Hakim has had a letdown after each string of strikes. Let's see if he can get that string going again here in the 8th frame.
Hey!
Barely nicked the 6 pin. He gets the 10 pin off the sideboard. Every good break so far for Peter Hakim today. That conversion gives him a 20 pin lead, yet they're 8. Their 8th frame is coming up, 3 frames to go, and Ron Palombi is looking sharp, his opponent.
And Pete, which they cheer about, whom they cheer about, answered their prayers, striking in the 8th frame. Started with 5 in a row, a couple of spares, now a strike. And Palombi has a double up, can cut Hakim's lead to 10 with a strike here in the 8th.
good-looking bachelor. Puts that rosin on his ball, takes the full approach. Chris, as you said, with a third strike, it will be just 10 pins difference with two frames to go.
And then this, the 6-7-10 for Palombi.
In inopportune times, he cuts right through the middle. He goes right through the middle, leaves these 6, 7, and 10 pins. And what Palombi has to do is get that ball over in the 6-7 area. Those two pins remaining on the right-hand side, slide the 6 over into the 7.
Hey! Pressure. And Vicky and Dennis Loon's son. Don't think he isn't with it. What a sports fan watching with us.
DJ gets to see one of the great shots of the year on Professional Bowlers Tour in a most important time. Palombi nicks the 6 into the 7, keeps in the match. Once again, he still trails by 23 pins, two frames to go.
Great family sport. So many parents come out to see their sons when they reach the championship finals, like Ron's parents, like Peter's parents. So for Ron Palombi on that left lane, it'll be a two pin that he must cover, coming in the ninth frame.
Palombi high in the 8th, got away with the split, sends it wide here in the 9th, has left the simple spare, the two pin. He's now going at a 2:13 pace, Hakim 2:17 pace. Anybody can still win the match.
Our first match, 2:11 to 2:07, with Aulby beating Wallace. Then Hakim, who's up next, defeated Aulby 2:67 to 2:46. So another tight one. And I think it'll be a tight, I know it'll be an exciting welterweight fight between Mark Breland and Daryl Anthony. Anthony, 22 pro bouts. Breland, only 10, but extremely talented. Then World Whitewater Canoeing.
Peter Hakim, now he has to make a decision. Should he go for this split and bring the match down to where he would be in a position he could lose, or just go for the one pin and stay ahead in the count? I would shoot for the one pin, Chris, stay ahead in the count, okay, and force Palombi to throw a double to take the lead.
There's the strategy. Figures in often in this sport.
A mistake he may pay for.
Looked like he was trying to get them both. Greedy. Perhaps greed set in.
As Ellen looks on, Chris, he doesn't know the score because he doesn't need to go for both pins. You have to analyze the score sheet as he looks over now. Palombi going at a 2:13 pace and Hakim at a 2:23 pace. Anybody can win the match. Look at how that number of 3 has come up in the scoreboard. A big mistake by Hakim. Let's see if he gets away for him with it. 10th frame.
Delayed reaction.
Hakim, the good break in the 10th. The 3-pin goes to the sideboard, trips out the 6 and 10 pins. He's put himself in a position where he can lock out Ron Palombi. He's got to like this. Anything could have happened on that strike. Something good. Another strike right here for Peter Hakim. And he will go on in the final match against powerful Storm DeVincent.
Graphically, very simple. Strike and one pin. All right. Now carefully making sure what he needs.
Right now he knows the score. He knows he needs a double to rectify that mistake he made in the 9th frame. He has it. Just keep the ball in the building. Stay behind the foul line. He'll go on to meet Storm DeVincent. And if you haven't seen Storm Bowl, it's something interesting.
All right, a man who got off the hook, his own hook. This doesn't happen too often in bowling. You make an error and you can't come back, but he has won his second match. Peter Hakim going against Thorne. Now we've had three matches, gone through the semifinal. Rather close match. Peter Hakim got off the hook to win his second match of the afternoon. This one over Ron Palombi. With eight strikes, Palombi 7, 232 to 223. Wide World follows us here on ABC. And, of course, tomorrow, Major League Baseball returns to ABC Sports. New York Mets, Philadelphia Phillies, or you perhaps will see Toronto Blue Jays in Kansas City. And, Nelson, what a performance today since we're on Long Island by a native Long Islander who pitches for the Royals. Dennis Leonard, who hadn't pitched since May of 1983, undergoing four leg operations, pitched a three-hitter as Kansas City beat Toronto today, 1-0. That's a performance. His first start since 83. Nice going.
Well, it's hard to say yet, but Kansas City, undoubtedly the world champion with Saberhagen and then Leonard coming back like this, Chris, is definitely the team to beat in the American League. The Mets, the National, but they still got to get by the Cardinals, and Storm DeVincent and Peter Hakim, one of these players, is going to get a trip to the Firestone Tournament of Champions after this game. Neither player has ever been in the winner's circle. Mm-hmm. Peter, the local favorite, knows the championship pair, averaged 249.5 so far. Let's see if he looks back as he has a chance to win the title and starts becoming protective.
Forest Hills, New York against Tamarack, Florida. He was happy with that because of the hit leaving the 2-4-7.
Game number one for Peter Hakim, eight strikes in a row. Game number two for Peter Hakim, five strikes in a row. The championship game, a little different. Starts with a bit tentative, leaves the 2-4-7 pin standing, a tough spare. Semi-fingertip grip.
We've had a year of first-time winners. Here you have a 29-year-old and a 30-year-old looking for their first titles. For Hakim, that you just saw perform, it was his first career championship round, and this is only the third for Storm. The control of speed. Beautiful, beautiful stroke.
That touch. Big body, that good touch, Chris, as you said, good speed control. An excellent clutch player for strikes, has had trouble when he needs spares to win. As you see his profile, he shovels that ball off that wrist, throws the biggest hook of all the players in the championship round today. And if he can keep it in the pocket, look out.
And the tournament leader, Storm DeVincent of Tamarack, Florida, leaves the 10-pin on the left lane.
Storm's ball rolled out. You see all that hook, and then all of a sudden it quit as it entered the 1-3 pockets. The ball must keep driving, keep spinning at that point. Storm's going to have some trouble carrying the 10-pin if that continues to happen. He has to either spin it more or throw it harder.
First game for this man, Storm DeVincent, but it's the third. Two victories now for the Long Island championship.
It's just down the road, Forest Hills, Chris, right by the Belmont Racetrack, which is one of the events we like to see.
And the first Saturday in May starts ABC's coverage of thoroughbred racing with the Kentucky Derby, followed by the Preakness. And we're glad to say that the third jewel has been added. That's right, the Triple Crown, live and in color on ABC this year. All right, and that's live and in color. And the third one being the Belmont Stakes, of course.
The 4-7 for mm-hmm. Hakim to trail by two pins. Chris, would you agree that he's gotten a bit tentative here as he sees the championship in front of him?
I really think he has now. Big as strong as he is, I doubt if he's tiring, but I don't know. You can walk about. Next Saturday, the Greater Hartford Open, Windsor Locks, Connecticut. We'll be there.
see if he picks up the speed.
Well, his father, Mac, appreciates that. That's his mother alongside. Now, Storm DeVincent, whose only representative here today is his wife, Lou Ann. Gliding, rolling so gently into that 1-3 pocket, and there is Lou Ann.
Lou Ann, who flew in from Florida today, a beautiful girl, obviously, and such a, you got to see the personality, just kind of a wry smile on her face. I think she's more nervous than Storm. And the key shot for Storm is going to be, can he hit the left-hand lane? It hooks quite a bit more. He has to send the ball wide, keep it from rolling out. He could take a 12-pin lead with a strike here in the fourth.
Just that. Luann's husband, Storm. The championship match will continue here at the Garden City Bowl, live and in color on ABC. But first, we're pausing for this message.
The $125,000 Greater Hartford Open next Saturday on ABC Sports.
Next Saturday from Windsor Locks, Connecticut. Today, here in Garden City, Long Island, New York. From Forest Hills, New York. His third game, Peter Hakim. Trailing by 12, has a strike up, he can cut it to 2. Right lane.
Peter Hakim, for the first time today, has been off in his game. He was high in the first frame, leaving the 2, 4, and 7 pins. High in the second, the 4, 7. A good solid strike in the third. And then once again throws the ball a little too hard this time and leaves the 3-5 spare. Has to guard against chopping the 3 off the 5. And remember last week, left-hander Rod Pastor, this was his downfall missing this combination.
Another local favorites in this tournament, Don Gianello was 32nd, Mark Roth 49th. This man looking for his first title. Finished third, and now has a chance to be number one. Storm DeVincent, the tournament leader, is his opponent. DeVincent, when he shoots next, will have a double working. Spare up fifth frame for Hakim.
Well, you pick a lane that fits your style, and Storm DeVincent likes the right-hand lane. He likes the lane slick and yet be able to play the big hook. He's been perfect on this lane in the first and third frames. He can take a 22-pin lead with a strike here in the fifth.
Tough break for Storm, leaving the 10.
Once again, Storm gets that what we call the rollout shot. Watch this ball. It looks like it's going to break, and then all of a sudden it straightens out. You see it kind of deflect as it enters the 1-3 pocket, all that hook, and yet still doesn't drive over into the 8-pin area. That's a result of not having enough speed or spin on the ball.
Lots of speed to cover the 10-pin, DeVincent. There are many incentives to win, and Storm told me one of his big ones was he'd like to get known so he could get a pro shop operation somewhere.
Well, he's down in that Florida area where Palmer Falgren, a good friend of mine, had such a successful pro shop. Tamarack area, we had a tournament in the Tamarack area, Don Carter Lanes years back. We're now down in the Kendall area. Now here's Storm DeVincent, 6th frame, leads by 11.
Contrast in styles, and we've had that from game one right through to the championship game you're watching now.
Storm DeVincent plays inside, lets it go outside, then drives back, rips the 5 over into the 4-7 area, and continues to keep the pressure on Peter Hakim. This is the shot that Hakim can make a match out of it. With a strike up, a strike here in the 6, he would only trail by 1 pin.
3-5-6 for the left-hander.
3-5-6. He had the 3-5 on this same lane in the fourth frame. He converted it by getting the ball right there to the left of the 3-pin and driving through the 5. Once again, we go back to last week's match. Rod Pastor, if he had converted this particular spare in the third frame, could have gone on to win the title. Let's see what Hakim does with it here in the sixth.
Pressure mounting now on these two non-winners. One that does will go to the Firestone Tournament of Champions. Walter Ray Williams, whom we heard from earlier, is the leading money winner with two victories this year, over 86,000. Tom Kreitz, Steve Cook, David Ozio, and Mark Roth.
Mark Baker, who has been on a little trouble lately, Skidmore, Randy Peterson, Brian Voss, and a former winner here, Don Janello, round out the top 10. Seventh frame, Peter Hakim trails by 11, spare up.
All but the 10.
You can see Peter picking up his speed. The first match, he was nice and firm, but not throwing the ball down or letting it roll. Now he's trying to force the ball, make it hook towards the pocket, make it turn over, and is not getting the good string of strikes that he had in his first two matches. He's been perfect on his spares today, though.
Storm DeVincent. And Peter, even matches. You look at Peter Hakim while we're away, as we're running behind our allotted time schedule. An open frame in the seventh for DeVincent, a spare in the eighth, covering an 8-pin. Spare up, and Peter Hakim, who's won two matches for his hometown fans. And there they shout, trying to fire him up. He's had two big games and struggling here a little bit, Nelson.
Chris, what fired him up was the open that Storm DeVincent handed to him in the seventh frame. Storm left the 2, 4, 5, and 8, failed to convert the 4-pin, then spared here in the 8th frame, and he slid right by. Now watch what happens. This is Storm's spare in the 7th frame to stay in the lead. He slides by, leaving the 4-pin. That makes the match all even, and it was a shot of adrenaline for Peter Hakim, who can now take the lead for the first time in the match. 9th frame.
Twisting the screw, and the dad is right behind him. You know, you have to have lived in New York all the years I did and have to appreciate New York sports fans. They get with it.
Storm DeVincent, can he retaliate?
Oh, the 10.
Storm DeVincent's ball, and I'll say it again, is rolling out. Normally his ball continues to spin and drive through the pins. He left the 10-pin in the second frame on that shot, the 10-pin in the fifth frame on that shot, and here in the 9th frame he left the 10-pin again.
Let's have a little tip on how we correct that.
A little more speed, Chris, and or a little more spin to keep the ball driving at the back end.
Okay. Storm DeVincent battling for that elusive first victory, as is Hakim. And as the tournament leader, leading in the fifth and sixth rounds, this 30-year-old from Tamarack, Florida, who grew up in Massachusetts. And Storm is his legal first name, born during a hurricane.
Well, he needs a hurricane of strikes right here. For the first time, he is behind in the match and must perform under the pressure. 10th frame, trails by 11. Chris, I've watched Storm DeVincent bowl for 3 or 4 years, and he's a gentleman and a great athlete. He had two championships in his pocket. He had one in Columbus and one in Florida, where he needed just a spare to win the match, but he couldn't get the spare. But for when he needs a strike, he says, I feel more confident. Right now, he needs this strike to give himself a good chance to win the tournament.
And his wife, Luann. Pressure.
Storm DeVincent at his best. Sends it wide when he needs it. Just saws that 5-pin into the 4-7 zone. With one more strike, he would finish with 206 and force Hakim the strike to win. Look at those eyes. He wanted it and he got it.
What a performance by Storm DeVincent, shooting a 206, three in a row at the very end, and now. Well, it was worth that.
The pressure Storm DeVincent, he performed under. Right now, this is the best chance we've ever had for a tie in my 12 years sitting in this seat in a championship game. If Peter Hakim gets nine spare strike, we have a tie at 206, and we would have a two-frame roll-off for the title. Winner!
Look at that. You know, there is a bowler that accepted the challenge three times. First against the bowler of the year, Aulby, 267-246. And then against Palombi, 232-223. He just bows his back, and from the left side, a tough loss for Storm DeVincent. Hakim from Forest Hills, and a spot where he's bowled for a long time, will be in the 210s, whereas DeVincent has shot a 206. And Buddy Russell, the proprietor here, John Caprice, president of the Nassau County Proprietors, with the trophy, $18,000 check, but for Hakim, more important, a trip to Firestone as he finishes the game. He will have shot a 216 to DeVincent's 206. Quickly now to Nelson Burton.
This victory, unbelievable.
This is the greatest day of my life. I'd just like to thank everybody here at Garden City Bowl, Mr. Russell, and all the bowling proprietors in Nassau County, all the girls in the office, and you guys were the best.
I made it through this whole tournament. Peter, a dream come true. Buddy Russell, you have a check.
$18,000. We congratulate you and thank you for a great week that you made for us.
Thank you very much.
And John Caprice, the trophy.
Pete, on behalf of the Nassau County Bowling Proprietors, I'm indeed pleased to present this championship trophy. Thanks for a great week.
Great week. Peter Hakim wins the match. Chris, one of the most exciting of all times. Up to you, Paul.
Okay, and a proud wife, mom and dad right there. Coming up next on ABC's Wide World of Sports, undefeated Olympic gold medalist Mark Breland is looking to avenge his only loss as an amateur. He'll meet Daryl Anthony, who beat him in the 1981 National Amateur Championships. It's a welterweight bout.